first day of this FDP program on emerging trends in mechanical engineering science and green energy sponsored by AICT. Now may I request to our head of the department, Dr. Munish Chhabra, to please welcome and present a bouquet to our eminent speaker, Professor Rakesh Saxena. Just sir, please.
Welcome.
So please have a listen to us.
Wonderful.
So now let me introduce to our eminent speaker, Professor Rakesh Saxena. He has done his BTech from IIT Kanpur. And he did his master's from the University of Manitoba, Canada. He was honored his doctorate from the University of Washington, USA. He also has worked in the reputed government organization, ONGC, and now he is serving the G.B. Pant University as a professor. So please welcome with the use of the professor. Professor, please accept. Sir, please.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you very much. And good afternoon, everyone. Okay, let's see. Is the board here, right?
Board
is
marked.
Do we have some marker? Okay, great.
Let's go full screen.
Some latest research going on in this field. So you can see there are two topics, the properties of trabecular bone and prosthetic engineering. Okay. So this is kind of collaborative work. We had a wonderful team both in Vermont and Washington which consisted of mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, doctors, scientists, radiologists, and various subjects. Okay, so we had a wide variety of people working on these projects. Alright, and so I'll be using several biological terms. So I want to keep it more interactive. Okay, so in case if you have any doubts, any queries, just shoot it right away. Okay, I'll try to answer it. So first of all, I'm sure most of you have not heard about at least trabecular word, the word trabecular, okay? Rest all are fairly straightforward. Prosthetic means artificially you make limbs, right? Hands, artificial legs, etc. So that comes under prosthetic engineering. But trabecular, that's very interesting. It's any bone. See, human bones, we have in our skeleton so many bones, okay? Now, there are two kinds of bones, okay? One is called cortical bone and trabecular. So we are talking about long bones. When I say long bones, we are talking about the bones in the leg, lower limb. This is called lower limb, this is called upper limb. So in the leg we have tibia, fibula, in the distal region. Now again, distal and proximal. These are two words. Distal means away from the main body. So these tibia and fibula in the distal region, and femur, right? The one that goes from knee up to the hip, that's called femur. That's in more proximal region. Proximal means closer to the body. Okay. So before even we get into, okay, let me explain what trabecular bone is. So these are some of the long bones. They look something like this, right? And so they consist of cortical part, C-O-R, cortical, and this is called trabecular, or also cancellous bones. Okay, trabecular is fairly solid. Okay, and so all the outer region. This is cortical, which is fairly solid. This is hollow, filled with some soft material. Okay, and here you have fairly hollow part. Okay, these are called trabeculae. This comes from the trabeculae, which means beam, beam-like structures. Okay, so mechanical people, they can relate to beam, right? So this is more hollow. This is fairly solid structure. So the solid is called cortical, and this hollow portion, is sponge-like portion, is called trabecular. And why we are interested in trabecular part is also fairly important. For example, most of the fractures, okay, they occur in the trabecular region. For example, the fractures in the vertebra, or vertebral region, right? Or distal radius and ulna, right? So distal means away. So your wrist, we are talking about wrist part, right? And the third part is the proximal femur, which is hip joint. Okay, proximal again, which is closer to the body. This is distal, this is proximal. Okay, so proximal femur, let's say hip joint. So I'm sure all of us, we know that especially when older people, right, middle age or even older than middle age, they fall, and the general reflexive tendencies are to put your hand there, and they get a fracture right there, or in the hip region, or in the spine, vertebral region. These three are very common regions where the fractures, they occur. Okay, so and these, all the three, they have what is called trabecular type of hollow bones. Okay, fracture will almost never occur in the cortical part. Fracture will almost never, unless something hits you. Okay. But mostly when you fall down or you slip, okay, these are the major regions where the fractures occur, and they occur in the trabecular region. And why they occur? Because as we grow older, or for some other reason also, this becomes more hollow. Okay, and in fact, osteoporosis, I mean, we all know the hard word osteoporosis. Osteo refers to bone. Osteo means bone. Porosis means pores. Porosis. So pores. Okay? So osteoporosis is a condition when you lose your bone mass. Okay? Your bone becomes more hollow. Okay? And obviously then there's more possibility of getting it fractured. Right? So this part, osteoporosis, refers to a loss of bone mass. Okay? And so that's why, as a mechanical engineer, okay, now there are several ways. One is the physical properties of a bone. Properties. Okay, what are physical properties? The bone volume fraction, BVF. How much bone is there, and how much hollowness is there? Bone volume fraction. Greater than 70%. Refers to a cortical part, and less than 70% means trabecular part. Okay, so those are physical properties. How these physical properties relate to mechanical properties? What are mechanical properties? Strength, stiffness, okay, and how much energy it can absorb. So energy absorption. And why we are interested in these mechanical properties? We are because they directly relate to the possibility of fracture. Now you can appreciate how important is to relate these mechanical properties with the physical properties, because they all will lead to a fracture of bone, and we want to avoid that situation. Okay, so this is a general kind of introduction to the trabecular bone and why this is so important. Okay, and we'll see a lot of our theory. It's simple. As a mechanical engineer, you know when a spring, okay, and you apply your force P, and suppose the stiffness is K, it gets displaced by X, so KX equals P. This is just one of the simplest equations, right? You can obtain this by either Newton's second law, or this is of course static in this case, so it's just a static force balance, P or D'Alembert's principle. They both will lead to the same kind of equation, and we'll see how we apply this equation to trabecular bone. Okay, so I'm giving you an overall picture before getting into detail. Okay, so this is an overall picture. So to see the possibility of fracture, we carry out this Kx equal to P. Okay, and we find out the displacement. Okay, from displacement we have obtained the strain using Hooke's law, right? du by dx is a strain, correct? The displacement upon the original length. And once you have strain, you multiply by E, Young's modulus, you get stress. Now every bone, right, the bone material has a fracture strength or yield strength. These are the properties of bone, okay? So you compare this stress with the actual stress the bone is going through, and then that will tell you whether there's a possibility of fracture or not. So now you appreciate why we do all this, okay? Because eventually we want to find out whether the bone is going to fracture or not, okay? So we do all this, and it involves a lot of different fields. Like I said, we had a fairly diverse crowd of doctors, radiologists, okay, patients themselves. We had patients who come to our lab, we will take their CAT scan, okay, and then use those slides to get the shape of the bone, okay, and then do some finite element analysis, which is a very powerful numerical method, okay, and I'll tell you why we do finite element method, okay, and so then we do all this static analysis, okay. This is called linear static. That's the simplest form of analysis. It's called LSA, linear static analysis. You all know that for a single degree of freedom, we have mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx equals applied force P, right? So in this case, the dynamic forces are the inertia force and the damping force, okay? But if they do not change with time, then we can neglect these, okay? And then we are left with what is called Kx equal to P, which is linear static analysis. Okay, here I'll keep on giving some name of some good books. Okay, an excellent book is called Dynamics of Structures. Dynamics of Structures. Okay, we have it in our library. I also have it as in my personal copy of this book. This is one of the best books. It's written by Clough and Penzian. Clough and Penzian. They both were professors at University of Berkeley, okay, and Clough is a person who coined the term finite element method. Professor Clough, okay, very famous guy. So in case you want to keep a book for rest of your life and you are in this field, go ahead and buy this book, Dynamics of Structures by Clough and Penzian. Okay, and another book, Finite Element Methods, finite element methods by K.J. Bathe. Again, he is still a professor at MIT, Boston. Excellent guy, okay. And his book is one like a Bible, okay. K.J. Bathe, he has developed a very strong finite element software called ADINA, A-D-I-N-A, very high-end software, okay, for non-linear analysis, etc. Okay, so these two books are excellent books. All right, so this is now you can appreciate why we are interested in the analysis of trabecular bone. All right, and the second part, of course, prosthetic engineering, where we develop artificial limbs. There are two kinds of limbs for the legs. One is called below knee, one is called above knee. Below knee are fairly simple, I mean compared to above knee. Below knee we have some sort of socket. So this is called a below knee. So you simply put your residual limb. So this is the person, this is the knee joint, and comes the, and this is called residual limb, okay, a tibia fibula, and this has been cut off. This could be some accident, it could be some disease, etc. Okay, so this is the design of the lower below knee. Above knee is more complicated. Why it is more complicated? Because you have to provide a knee joint. You have to provide a knee joint. So above knee becomes more complicated, and so you have one knee joint and then you have below the knee. So these two kinds of basically mainly prosthetics. And in India, we have very famous company or trust rather. They make these prosthetics called Jaipur foot. Okay, you might have heard, headed by Mr. Mehta, Jaipur foot. Very famous. Okay, and they give away. They don't sell these things. Okay, they give away to people who cannot afford. And otherwise also, they are fairly cheap. They can cost anywhere from 1500 to probably 2000 rupees. Okay, these prosthetic or residual limbs. Now compare this price with the ones that we were doing research in US and Washington. They cost anywhere greater than or equal to $10,000. Okay, so now you can see these are very low cost solution, and that's what we need. Okay, as opposed to very expensive, and there is a reason why they are very expensive, these residual limbs, because people are physically extremely active. They want to take part in Olympics, Paralympics, they want to climb Everest, etc. So these are made from a very lightweight material, some titanium alloy, etc. That makes them very expensive. So whereas here we are providing a very low cost solution so that you can simply walk, and so it's not, these solutions are not for very active kind of people. So both have their own place. All right, so we move next. Let me see, did I turn it off? Oh, so here's an outline of my talk. I'll just give a simple introduction to finite element method, background. Some of it I've already covered, the major objectives, what is the main methodology of carrying out this kind of research, the major results, and I'll try to conclude some of these results, and what is going on, and what is the possibility of work in the future, and what is the present technology, okay, in these fields, prosthetic engineering and artificial bone, okay. Now, I'm sure all of you have heard about this method called finite element method. See, there are two kinds of methods, analytical and approximate, right? A simple example, for example, a cantilever beam, okay, a cantilever beam you can write a partial differential equation, right? A simple cantilever beam, which is fixed at one end, free at another end. You can write a simple partial differential equation and get an analytic solution. Analytic solution. What is analytic solution? Analytics, there are other names for it. This is also called exact solution, also called a closed form solution. Closed form solution. All these three, they refer to the same thing, which means there is absolutely no approximation involved. Okay? However, this is applicable only to very simple cases, okay, like a simply supported beam, cantilever beam, fixed beam, etc. Okay, it's not that we cannot use these applications. For example, a cantilever beam. Two main applications could be, one could be the wing of an airplane, which is fixed at a fuselage and free at the other end. Okay, so that's a simple cantilever beam application. The other is building itself, a tall skyscraper, right? That's also a vertical cantilever beam. So you can still use these analytical solutions to as a first approximation for these applications, right? However, if the things become more complex, for example, take the case of trabecular bone, okay, then these analytical solutions, there's no way you can write any equation for those complex structures, okay. So you cannot write, so then you have to go for what is called approximate methods or numerical methods, okay. Approximate methods and or numerical method, they will give you only approximate solution, okay. And finite element method is one of the most powerful numerical method or approximate method that can analyze very complicated or complex structures. Okay, that will give you the approximate solution where you divide a continuous system with a discrete system. A continuous system, which is basically a beam which has infinite degrees of freedom. On the other hand, a discrete system, you approximate by a discrete system which has finite degrees of freedom. Finite degrees of freedom. So that's the first approximation what finite element method does. So like I said, you approximate, you divide a whole continuous body, okay, into small elements, and then you set up, this is called a stiffness matrix, which is shown on the right hand side, capital K. X is of course the displacement, and on the left hand side you have F, which is the force. Okay, so you basically you set up this kind of equation. Now you may ask, why do we need a computer to solve these equations? These are, by the way, simultaneous equations. What do we mean by simultaneous equations? Means all the unknowns, they occur in all the equations. They are coupled. Okay. For example, let me just show you a very simple 2x2 matrix. Okay. So a 2x2 matrix means, let's say K11, 12, 21, 22. Okay. X1, X2 equal to F1 and F2. A most common form of example is when this is known, this is a system property and external loading is known. So the only things which are unknown are X1 and X2. Okay? So these are two equations, two unknowns. I'm sure we can do it with just hand calculation. Right? Two equations, two unknowns. When I say coupled, we say because of these terms. You see, these terms are so important, off-diagonal terms. These are called off-diagonal terms, and these are so important because they make the things very complex. Imagine, now if I tell you, if this is K11, 0, 0, K22, X1, X2, you have two kinds of systems, A and B. Okay, here comes my first question, which is easy to solve, A or B? Anyone?
B.
Very simple, right? Why B is? Because these are uncoupled equation. First equation has only x1 unknown and the second equation has only x2 unknown. So they can be solved independent of each other. On the other hand, the system A, they are coupled because of these off-diagonal terms, these being non-zero. So x1 and x2, they occur in both the equations. Okay, that's why system A is very difficult to solve. So many of you who have taken course in vibration, okay, there's one thing what you do, principal mode analysis, etc. You try to uncouple those equations. Principal eigenvectors, eigenvalues, etc. Right? You try to uncouple those equations. Now this becomes even coupled equations 2 by 2 is very easy to solve. Now what do you think? For example, in case of, I'll tell you trabecular bone, the size of A is a square matrix is n by n. Now what should n can be anywhere from 10 to power 5 to 10 to power 7. Can you imagine that? So it can, anywhere it can go from 1 lakh to 1 crore or 10 million. Now there's absolutely no way of doing it manually. Even more than 5 by 5 becomes fairly complex doing with hand. Okay, that's why we go for computers, digital computers, which can solve such a huge set of equations, a million by a million equations. Okay, so that's why we apply this. So solving f equal to kx itself is a big job, and we use very efficient algorithms to solve this. Okay, now the application of this is not only limited to structural analysis, solids and structures. The similar can be used for heat transfer, fluids, etc. Okay, so there's a beauty. Mathematical equations are same, even electrical engineering also. Okay, for example, a very simple example I'll give you where the equations are almost what identical. So if you can solve one, for example, a vibration, single degree of freedom system, you have mx dot cx dot plus kx equals 0 or equals, let's say, f. Okay? What is RLC circuit? R, L, and C. Okay? And a battery. So, L, D2, Q, Q double dot plus R, Q dot plus C upon Q. Q upon C, sorry. Equal to E. This is for electrical. Okay. Now you can see the identical equation. X gets replaced by Q. Q is the charge. So similarly, a finite element package, a very popular package is called ANSYS. Okay, ANSYS is one of the oldest packages. ANSYS. Okay, so using ANSYS, you can solve any of these problems, plus including electrical problems. Okay, because they all have similar equations, mathematical equations, right? Here it says same thing what I told you earlier. It was coined by Clough, the professor at Berkeley. The important thing is finite element solution can never give more information than it contained in the mathematical model. So don't think ANSYS can give you all the answers in the world. There are a lot of approximations involved in ANSYS. Okay, so you have to be very careful. You should know what are those approximations, and accordingly, your solution will also be cannot be exact solution. But you have to be careful that ANSYS cannot give you exact answers. Okay. Now here comes. I'll try to do it quickly. A normal bone. Bone is very interesting. Okay. Coming back to the same trabecular bone part, bone is very interesting. You may think bone always, there are two parts of bone, two phases rather. One is called modeling, another called remodeling. Modeling is when a child is growing up. So that's called modeling. Modeling of home. Okay? And then remodeling. So in what happens, let me tell you what bone consists of. So suppose on the left hand side you're shown a figure of a typical cross section of a bone, okay? And let me see. Okay, here. So it consists of two main phases. One is a living phase called cells. Okay. So these are the cells, those round ones, and non-living, which consists of fiber, kind of collagen fiber, elastic and non-elastic both, and a matrix. Okay. Usually calcium phosphate kind of material. Okay. So the living material is these cells, and similar cells, they give rise to what is called tissue. Okay. So muscle is one tissue, fat is another tissue, blood is another tissue, because they all contain similar type of cells. Alright? So those are called, and various tissues, when they join together, they give rise to what are called organs. Like stomach is an organ, right? Etc. etc. Trabecular bone is an organ. Cartilage is an organ, because they contain the similar cells. Alright? And I'll give you a little bit from mechanical point of view. These fibers, okay, collagen fibers, etc., both elastic and non-elastic, they are there so that a bone can take tensile loads. Alright? And on the other hand, the matrix or the calcium phosphate kind of mineral, okay, that can take the compressive load. Alright? So when a person, a child, for example, is mostly cartilage. It's very flexible, pliable. Okay. So they are not very hard. The bones are not very hard. Okay. But they can bend without getting fractured. And when we grow older, what happens? Some of these, we get what is called calcification, more mineralization. Okay. So the bone becomes hard. Okay. It's no more pliable. And if you are so, this is initially it's very soft and pliable, and then when it becomes adult, okay, then it's a good balance between pliability and mineral. So both it can take compressive load as well as tensile load. But beyond, if you become older, then it becomes more hard, okay, and less pliable. That's why you encounter all these fractures. All right, so this is basic constituents of a bone. And what is modeling? Modeling is when a child is growing up to adult and up to 30 years, okay, the bone grows. So you get, so up to 30 years, so suppose this is time, so up to 30 years, let's say, and this is bone mass, so maximum bone is at 30 years, okay, maximum bone mass. And then slowly the bone mass keeps on decreasing. Okay. And this part is called remodeling. This is modeling where the, now in remodeling itself, it's not that the bone is just getting reduced. There are two things going on. One is called building of bone, and breaking of bone. Continuously till we live. And if this breaking of bone, the rate of breaking of bone is larger than building, then you lose bone mass. On the other hand, if building of bone is more than rate of breaking of bone, then you gain mass. Okay. And it's very interesting what factors will build the bone. What factors will build the bone? I'll just tell you in a second, but let me just show you what these bone remodeling. Now there are two kinds of cells, one are called osteoblasts and osteocasts. Okay. So this, initially what happens, this is the phase, neutral phase, and then osteoclasts denoted by OC. Okay, these cells, they osteoclasts, OSTEOCLASTS. These, they resort the bone. So basically you are losing the bone. Okay. Then after some time there's a reversal. Nobody knows how all these the cells, they send a message to the brain, and then the reversal takes place. Then osteoblast cells, they come. Nobody knows from where. Okay. And they start building the bone. Again the same period, 1 and 6. They are same. So this is called a bone remodeling. Continuous breaking of bone and again building of bone throughout your life. Okay, throughout your life. Now, how you can increase the rate of building of bones? For example, all these astronauts and cosmonauts, when they go in the space, they lose bone mass. You know why? Because there's no gravity. There's no gravity. So what is a compressive load normally increases the bone mass. A compressive load in a cyclic compressive load, not just a constant compressive load. A cyclic compressive load will increase the bone mass. That's why you are asked, there was a control experiment about 60 years old and older people. One group was given to just lift the dumbbells, about not more than 5 kgs. And they did it, after 6 months they found the people who were lifting these dumbbells, they had a better bone mass than who were not. Okay. So it's always a good idea for both males and females to do little bit of weight lifting. That will always increase your bone mass, especially when you are getting older. Don't go for a very large amount of weights. A 5 kilogram is good enough. Okay. So do some, keep your dumbbells at home and start doing some weight lifting, and that will make your bones stronger and you will not lose bone mass. Okay. That's why when these astronauts, can you believe, now of course things have changed over recent years. When they are in the space or space station, almost 4 or 5 hours they continuously, they do exercise so that they don't lose bone mass. Earlier when they used to come back on Earth after a long time, they could not stand. If they stand, their legs will fracture. So they were immediately provided some chairs, etc., so that they don't stand. Okay. Otherwise, your body will put the bones, trabecular part especially, has become so hollow that it cannot take the body weight of the body. Okay. Because there's no compressive load in that space. All right. So this is something very interesting. Bone modeling and remodeling. Now, there are 3 ways of doing some analysis of these bones. It's called, what are those 3 ways? In vivo, I'm sure some of these terms are fairly common and many of you already know. In vivo, next is in vitro, and third is computational. Okay? In vivo is when you are analyzing the bone, when the bone is already in the living organism. Okay? Then you can try what is the hardness, what is the strength, etc. in vivo. In vitro is when part of the bone, you take it out, okay, and then test it in the lab. The hardness, the strength of the bone. That's called in vitro. And computational is what we guys do, is we set up a computational model, solve it using finite element method, etc., and we try to get the properties. But always they complement, all these 3 methods, they complement each other. Okay? Because you cannot just do in vivo. In vivo is fairly complex, and you cannot, this kind of, you have not very safe also. Okay? It can lead to some infection, etc. Okay? So in vivo, although it gives very good results, okay, but it's difficult. In vitro, again, when you are taking out the bone from the body, from the living organism, its properties may change. So in vitro may not give as accurate results as in vivo. Finally, computational model is the safest. Is the safest. But then the results, how can you rely on those results? It's all mathematics. So you have to do a lot of validation. See, always, whenever you are writing your thesis, doing some research, and you are working with this finite element method, okay, don't just send it to your ANSYS and get some results and publish it. Validation is one of the most important factor of your research. How can you validate your results? You can validate your results using either in vivo results or in vitro results or some other kind of experiment. So they always, you have to check how good your results are from finite element method. Always remember, okay? So you should have full confidence, because anyone can ask you, okay, you may present some results, heat transfer or structural analysis or anything, fluid mechanics, right? And people may ask, how do we know that these results are right? Just because you have set up some computational or mathematical model and you have got some results does not mean those results are right, okay? So you must validate them. There are so many ways of validating, okay? One, your computational model itself, whether it's correct or not, we'll tell you few results which we have validated. I'll tell you how we validated them. But there are various ways of validation. But validation itself is extremely important, okay? That you got to validate your computational results, right? All right. So we go next. Okay. I keep forgetting which is forward, which is back.
Sir, now, excuse me, sir.
Huh, tell me.
Sir, just a general question. Whether it is important to validate experimental results also?
Whether it's... In a way, yes. You definitely have to check the repeatability of experiment. Suppose you are doing some experiment. You have to provide me everything. What was the temperature? What was the ambient condition? And if I do the same experiment with what you have, I should get the same results. So repeatability is again very, very important word in research. I should be able to reproduce what you got. So just because you have done one experiment does not mean that is correct. One is you specimen. For example, if you are testing in a specimen, right? You get, okay, the tensile strength is so many pascals or whatever, megapascal, GPa, whatever, right? But I'll tell you, have you tested 6 specimens? How many have you tested? 10, 6, where do you stop? Whether you are going to test, then you have to do some statistical analysis. Okay, what should be your population size so that your results are reliable? Okay, so even experimental results, to answer your question in short, yes. Experimental results also, just there are so many ways of validating your experimental results also. I mean, I don't know, did I answer it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
All right. Now here, this is typical vertebral, human vertebra disc from the back. This was done by Dr. Keller, who was my PhD advisor. And you can see it's fairly hollow. The only the part near the wall is called cortical, which is fairly solid. But otherwise, this is the rest of it is called the trabecular part. And you can see how complex it is. Obviously, you cannot do any analytical analysis, right? You set up. We'll tell you how to set up a finite element model, okay, and try to analyze. Now, this is again by Gibson and Ashman. This brings me third book for today's talk. Again, remember, I'm telling you these books, these are amazing books, and you must have these books in your library, or you can even purchase it as your personal. This book is called Cellular Solids. Cellular Solids. Again, an amazing book by Laura Gibson. She is a professor at MIT. And Ashley. Okay. This is an excellent book, Cellular Solids. Now, she gives such a nice picture. What are cellular solids? Wood. Wood is a cellular solid. A honeycomb structure. That's very popular. All the fuselage, plane structures, right? They are made out of honeycomb. Do you know why honeycomb? Because it's light and stiff. And in a plane, you require not only what is called strength to weight ratio. Strength to weight.
this should be fairly high. The material should be light and the material should be high in strength. There is a plane called SR-71. Have you heard about SR-71? It's called Blackbird. It's the fastest plane so far people have. And of course it has been decommissioned. You can only see in the Smithsonian Museum in Washington. SR-71 is made out of titanium. And that's why it's called Blackbird. Very interesting. Just go to Wikipedia and read about this plane. It can fly more than 3 times the speed of sound. And why? Because titanium has a very high strength to weight ratio. Okay. And why we need this? Because again, from the fuel consideration, etc., etc. Okay. So where were we? Yeah. So wood, honeycomb structure, sponge, bone. Okay. They all are cellular solids. And she has taken one chapter describing wood, another chapter describing bone, etc., etc. Amazing lady. Okay. So, and again, amazing book, cellular solid. Excellent book by Oxford Press, I think. So again, this is a must book for any good research in this field. Okay, cellular solids. Alright. So now here we see the important part of a bone. That basically you can see the tissue density is fairly constant, right? 1.9 grams per cm. On the other hand, the apparent density it varies a lot from 0.05 to 0.5 grams per cc. Okay. Why? Because of the variation in the bone volume fraction, which can go anywhere from 5% to 25%. So this is, we are talking only about the trabecular bone. Cortical bone will have obviously very high bone volume fraction, pretty close to 1. Okay. 1 means a solid bone, 0 means no bone. Okay. So bone volume fraction is kind of a sponge, right? A sponge has a material property and then the property of a sponge itself. A macroscopic versus microscopic. Alright? So these are some of the properties, physical properties of trabecular bone. Alright? So these bones, there has been research for a long time, almost like 30-40 years, even more, where how these the trabecular bone was analyzed. Okay, and earlier research they took the bone and represented it by identical unit cells. Okay, identical unit cells means maybe cubic structures, right? A bone like this, then another structure like this, identical structures. This is just an idealization, and they put all those small cubes together to form the big bone. Okay. But this was just a first approximation, alright? This was followed by a two-dimensional finite element model. Okay. And so two-dimensional means just this kind of structure. Okay. And so it had some kind of, and then they had a uniform thickness in the third dimension, right? And followed by again voxel based detailed 3D models. This was a more recent phenomenon. Voxel is a generalization of pixel. We all have heard about pixels, right? Pixels are in two dimension. Voxel means, pixel means picture element, voxel means volume element. Okay, so this refers to a three-dimensional. So they came up with 3D finite element model. So what was this 3D model? Again, what are those called? Brick elements. I'm sure many of you have used these brick elements when you have done some finite element analysis. These brick elements had 4-8 nodes, and if one node had 3 degrees of freedom,
So this had 24 degrees of freedom. 24 degrees of freedom.
Okay?
XYZ, etc. But these are the problem with these so far was when you represent these by brick elements, then only those solids will be accurate if they are planar. For example, a box. Suppose you have a big box and you want to represent by brick elements. Absolutely no problem. You can represent by small brick elements, right? No error at all. Okay? Absolutely right. Okay. However, suppose even if one surface is, let's say, slightly curved, now you cannot represent by brick elements. Okay. Otherwise, there will be lot of errors. For example, this you can represent like this, but this jagged edge, you cannot get a smooth edge. Okay. This jaggedness will lead to lot of errors. So for that, we came up with what is called smooth surface 3D finite element models. Okay. Surface models. They use both tetrahedron and brick elements. Tetrahedron means, this is something very interesting. Tetrahedron has four nodes. Okay? Four nodes. Each node is again 3 degrees of freedom. So it has 12 degrees of freedom. So it has less. But these tetrahedrons can represent a rough surface much better than brick elements. Okay. So as far as accuracy is concerned, these tetrahedron elements are much better. But what do you lose? You lose in the accuracy. So this is geometrical. You have more accuracy. You can represent a surface much better by these tetrahedron elements as compared to brick elements. However, tetrahedron elements are very stiff. They're very stiff because they have less degrees of freedom. Now, this is something very important concept. Okay. Especially people who have done some research in a structural analysis. When you are representing a continuous body by a discrete body, what do you lose? A continuous body, like I said, has infinite degrees of freedom. Right? A discrete will have finite degrees of freedom. Finite degrees. So what will it make? Which will be more stiff? Discrete or continuous? Obviously, discrete will be more stiff. So the more degrees of freedom, the more flexible it will become. Okay. So ideally, you should have infinite degrees of freedom. But where do you lose out if you keep on increasing the degrees of freedom? Your computational effort. If you have more degrees of freedom, the size of k will keep on increasing. The size of k will go from 1000 to 10,000, million, etc. Okay? So your computational effort will increase. Also, there is a question of rounding off error, etc. That will also increase. So you have to strike a balance between your geometrical accuracy and your computational accuracy, your cost of computation, etc., etc. There are so many factors you've got to have a balance. Okay? So, now the objective of this research was to develop and make it automatic 3D modeling of trabecular bone. By automatic, what we mean is basically we had what kind of data did we have? We had two kinds of data. One was CT scan, another was the quantitative serial sectioning. The bone was actually sectioned mechanically, and we took a scan or photograph of those. And CT scan, we know, computed tomography, right? Similar to MRI. In fact, there's one called NLM. Have you heard about National Library of Medicine? And this is a government, GOV, US government. US is the only country, they don't put US because that's where they got this internet from. So other than US, every country has to put, for example, in India we put IM, etc. Right? So in US, you don't put, if it is registered with US, you don't put USA or US. So the NLM.gov, it's a government organization, National Library of Medicine. excellent. This is also related to NIH, National Institute of Health. So you can get very useful information from these sites. See, that's one thing I'm sure you all know by now. There's so much information. There's no lack of information on net. But you must know where to get the correct information. For example, Wikipedia, more than 50% of the information is wrong on Wikipedia. You'll be surprised. So that leads to what is called fake news, etc. So we, all of us, being educated people, we should not right away whatever is given on the net, we should not believe that. Okay. Even the properties of materials, etc. So always go. It's strongly recommended, always go for a good site. So these are some of the excellent sites: National Library of Medicine, National Institute of Health.gov, ASME for mechanical people.org, etc. So why I'm referring to this? There were two convicts in US, and they were given capital punishment, and they were supposed to die. Okay. So they donated their body for research. So their whole body was sectioned. So there were two ways what they did. They took the CT scan and QSS. Wanted it. They froze their body and sectioned it. Okay. One female and one male. And this whole thing is available on these sites. Very interesting. Now when you do this sectioning, you put them together, you do all this fitting of the surfaces, etc. And then these tissues, for example, muscle, fat, bone, they all have what is called a color value. They all have a color value. Muscle may have 15, fat may have 25, bone may have 75, etc. So what you do is, it's a very nice interactive site. If you give 75, the value 75, then it will display skeleton, only the bone part, and you can rotate it, you can zoom it. So it's very interesting. If you give 25, it will give you all the fatty tissues of the body, and 15, it will give you all the muscles. So a lot of computer algorithms have been developed, like marching cubes algorithm, Lorentzian and Klein. They developed those from which they actually obtain all this. This is the hard work they have done for 20 odd years. Okay, so you can get this, all these pictures, very nice pictures. Okay, you can rotate them, you can translate it, you can zoom it in, and so all these different type of tissue, blood circulation you can see, etc. Okay. Both the convicts. Okay. So at least they did one good thing, is donating their body. Okay. So we had to automate. So what did we have? We had a data of actual bone, human bone, in the form of CT scans. Okay. So each scan is a two-dimensional. That's the difference between CT and X-ray. Right? You all know the difference between X-ray and CT scan. X-ray is, it compresses the whole volume into a single slide. With CT scan, it will go like this, like this, like this, like this. It will go in the depth. Okay. 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, 3. It makes it more and more expensive depending on how close you want. Okay. Again, CT scan and MRI. MRI is non-radiative. This is also very important. The CT scan and X-ray, both have radiation. Okay. And it's almost advisable not to go for CT scan or X-ray. So MRI is safer and it's meant for soft tissue. That's why most of the time for brains, they do MRI. And for hard tissues like bone, etc., they do CT scan or X-ray. Okay? So, alright. So, what did we have? We had these CT scans, several of them together. Now, we had to put this CT, for example, a typical CT scan will look, for example, of the leg, will look tibia and fibula. Fibula is a smaller one. So, it will look something like this, okay? And there's no line, nothing. These are all pixels. So the bone was bright and non-bone was dark. So we had only this much information, bright and dark. Okay. Now what do? They are called edge detection algorithms. I'm sure many of electrical people have heard about this. How to detect an edge of an object. This is also very important for the traffic. Suppose you want to see the traffic control, etc. So, outline of a truck, outline of a car, outline of a human being. Okay? How do we detect the edge, outer edge? Okay? So, there are different algorithms we use for prosthetic engineering. We use what is called active contour algorithm. Active contour algorithm. Or this is also called snake algorithm. So this refers to basically we try to minimize the brightness. So there are two kinds of energies, brightness and bending energy. And this is something very, it looks very easy. So what we do is we automated it. So one slice came and we put this by the hand. We try to digitize it. We put some dots around tibia. And what happens, we applied active contour algorithm, they lock on. So every iteration, it moves forward until it locks onto the edge. So it's all very highly mathematical algorithm. And so that's how we got the edge of tibia. Similarly, we got the edge of fibula. Okay? So now we have, this we had to do for every slice. So using MATLAB, have you heard about MATLAB? It's by MathWorks. Okay, very famous company, MathWorks. MATLAB has been there for again last 40-50 years. Very powerful software, MATLAB. But it's fairly expensive. Do you guys have MATLAB here?
Yes, in computer department.
Computer, how many licenses?
Only one.
Only one. It becomes very expensive, but I'll tell you, open source. Anyone is aware of open source for MATLAB? Any, what's the name? The name is, there are several softwares you can even download on your cell phone or mobile, okay? Called Octave, O-C-T-A-V-E, Octave, FreeMat, FreeMat, Scilab, etc. Octave, FreeMat, a couple of more, they're all free. You can download it on your laptop, you can download it on your and these are almost 90% all the commands are same as MATLAB, but they are legal to use. I teach two courses, CAD and numerical methods, and both the courses I have labs using FreeMat software to my undergraduate students, and they do all the programming using FreeMat. So what we have done in our library, we have downloaded FreeMat, and all the students, they do programming using FreeMat. And once they know FreeMat, means almost 90% they know MATLAB. But the beauty of it is open source. It's freely available. It was developed by an Indian guy, Samit Basu. Samit Basu of UIUC, University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, UIUC. Very excellent university in US, okay? Samit Basu, he developed FreeMat. But then there are Octave and there are few more software. If you go to Google, you can check those softwares, okay, which are freely available. So they are legal to use. Okay. You can tell your students to start using, you can install in your lab. Okay? Alright. So using these algorithms, we for edge detection, we got the edge of tibia and fibula. Okay? And then we kept on getting, so I made an automated program. So after one slice, the next slice comes, the third slice comes, and we had about hundreds of these slices. So every slice will automatically, it'll give me this kind of edge of both the bones. Okay? And then I had several, we joined them by what is called interpolation. Okay? Interpolation. There are two techniques of fitting the data, interpolation and regression. Right? Regression, the curve usually does not pass through all the points, usually, okay? Because there's an error in one of the variables. Whereas in interpolation, Again, interpolation also, like Bezier curves need not pass through all the points, but in general, spline, etc., they pass through all the points. So we joined those points. After getting those points on the edge of tibia, we interpolated. What do we mean by interpolated? We joined them using splines, cubic splines, Hermite splines, etc. Okay? We did that. So we got a boundary of both tibia as well as fibula, right? And so once we had this, then since we are going in this one direction, depth, right? So we are going either from proximal to distal or distal to proximal, okay? And then we also did it in depth, and we fitted a spline in the normal to the boat. And then we did some surface fitting, etc. So we had a surface kind of picture of this bone, all right? And after this surface picture, what we did was finite element, we put the brick model or the tetrahedral model. So now, our objectives, they were to automate this whole process. Otherwise, it will take long time. So just I developed this program using MATLAB. We had MATLAB at that time. Okay, so developed a MATLAB program, made a GUI for this so that you just write the name of the slice and it starts. Once you start the process, everything becomes automatic. Okay, now what are those, what were our specific objectives? Convergence study and meshness. This is something very important. Validation. Okay, so this convergence study is one of the most important fundamental study when you do any finite element analysis. I'll tell you what convergence is. When you have some results, whether they are converging or not, at what point are they converging, whether you should take, how small the element should be, whether it should be 1 micron, should be 10 micron, or it should be 30 micron, how big your finite element should be. Again, I told you, the smaller element you take, the more computational effort. It will take longer time. So obviously, so you would like to keep your element as large as possible. But again, if you take too large, then your results may not be accurate. So again, you have to strike a balance between your accuracy and your computational time. So for that, you do a convergence study. We'll quickly see. So convergence study will tell me at what size of the element I get reasonably good results. That is called convergence study. So that's the first thing you do when you are doing any finite element analysis. Okay. The second point is extremely important. It says local. The word local is extremely important. What are the local tissue stresses and strains in the bone? I'll tell you, we applied only 1% of strain, the outer strain, and we found the local strains were fairly high, 4%, 5%. So which may lead to fracture. So these local stresses and strains were very important from fracture or possibility of fracture. Okay. Then effect of Poisson's ratio. Okay. Normally you can take about 0.3, but we varied from 0.1 to 0.4 and see whether the Poisson ratio has any effect on our results. And isotropy investigation. This is also very important. An isotropic material, we know the properties are same in all the directions, right? But the bone is not isotropic. So we tested it, we tried it in two orthogonal directions, and we found the properties are different. Okay? So that was, then this was extremely important, osteoporosis simulation. We reduced at the computer or image level, we reduced the wall thickness, etc., and see what this led to. Okay, whether this osteoporosis, we try to simulate it. Okay, so I told you osteoporosis basically is a loss of bone mass. Okay, so we did the simulation part and see how it affects the local tissue strains and stresses. And we also did a study on brick versus tetrahedral. I told you the brick elements, they give good results because they are softer, they have more degrees of freedom. Okay, so they give better results compared to tetrahedral elements, but tetrahedral elements, they give a better geometry. if your geometry is fairly complex, then the brick element will not be a good idea. Okay, because then because of the jagged edge, tetrahedral you can orient it anyways. Okay, so for a complex geometry like that of a trabecular bone, tetrahedral elements they serve the right purpose as far as duplication of geometry is concerned. On the other hand, brick elements they give better computational results. All right. So this is a general methodology of what we did for finite element model. So I told you we started with MRI or CT scan or histology. Histology is again same as QSS, quantitative serial sectioning. Then we subjected it to image processor. We selected a volume. Now this volume selected is extremely important. Okay. It comes from the homogenization theory. See, the bone is fairly big. What part of bone should you take? Whether you should take 10 millimeter by 10 millimeter by 10 millimeter, or you should take 5 millimeter by 5 millimeter by 5 millimeter. What size you should take? Okay. That comes from the fact that suppose what should be the size of what is called RVE, representative volume element. And that also depends on the trabecular thickness. Okay, trabecular means same beam type of structure. How thick they are. What this means, RVE, what this means is whether this small element can represent, it has the same property as rest of the bone or not. Again, it's somewhat analogous to statistical population. Okay, suppose there are 10 crores of people. Obviously, you are not going to ask everyone. It's not practically possible, right? So you will choose whether I choose 1,000 people or 100 or 1 lakh. That you have to decide logically. Obviously, it's not random. Logically, okay? Similarly, we decided the size of RVE that comes from the thickness of each trabeculae, etc. But this RVE is obviously smaller than rest of the bone. So we have to analyze a smaller portion. Again, this will reduce the computational effort if we have a smaller portion of bone to analyze. But what we are doing, we are assuming that the property of this smaller piece is same as the property of the whole bone. Okay, so that's something very important. So we did a smaller volume selector. Then we generated, we also took help from one software is called, again it is available on the net, go ahead, visualization toolkit, VTK. In fact, that convict, I told you the example, okay, it's, they have made this using this software, VTK. Earlier it was free during my time, now this professor, all these have been developed by university, not at a commercial level, but a university professor, he developed this. So when he was developing, we were in touch with each other. In fact, we helped him also with few algorithms. I'll tell you one very interesting part. One was when we get the surface mesh, how to get volume from surface mesh. Okay, this is something very interesting part was. So because again that is for validation. Okay, that is for validation. Because practically we had the piece of bone, we knew the volume, right? Mass. And volume, we had volume, but whether our finite element model, whether it had the same volume or not, how do we test it? So we had a surface mesh, from surface we had to calculate the volume. Okay, and this we use using what was the theorem, it's called I don't remember, I'll tell you. This typical theorem, which is in the second year of calculus, okay, that tells you how to find the volume from the surface mesh. And later on, they included the same algorithm in their software. Earlier, they could not calculate the volume. Okay, so anyway, so from surface, and that was another piece of validation. The model that we have made, the finite element model, how accurate that model is, because we knew the volume experimentally of the bone, okay, we knew the volume. Now the volume of the finite element model, we had only 2% difference, okay, so we are fairly close with our finite element model as far as volume was concerned. Okay. Then of course we could display also. So this was finite element volume mesh generator. Okay. You can see tobacco bone. And then the final part was finite element analysis, which is again linear static analysis. A simple kx is equal to f. Okay. Okay, these were some interesting. So we had our piece was 1.5 by 1.5 by 2 millimeter cube. Okay, and the surface mesh was 20,545 nodes, about 41,000 triangles. The surface mesh consisted of triangles. Okay, surface area was obtained, and then bone volume fraction was about 10%, less than 10%. Then we created, depending on the size of tetrahedra, we created different models from the same surface mesh. Okay, so these were the model names A1 through A9, and you can see the number of tetrahedra. So this is the largest. Okay, so A1 is the largest, and A9 has the smallest element. So that's why your number of tetrahedra is maximum about 51,000. And the largest tetrahedra, it was only 1700. We'll tell you why we made so many models. Okay, A1 through. So we have made 9 models. Okay, and this gives you some information: number of nodes, number of tetrahedra, mesh density, number of tetrahedras per unit of bone volume. So this had only very few because they were fairly large. And this had, imagine this has about 117,000 tetrahedras. Okay. Now, from tetrahedral to finite element, so modeling. Okay, so we, this is just volume of interest, the same as RVE. There's a typical algorithm called marching cubes algorithm. Okay, I'll not get into details, but I'll tell you the main steps. Marching cubes algorithm. We extracted the largest region. This is also very important. What happens if this bone? Okay, when you there some elements are not even joined. Okay, they don't have any common. So they are just hanging out. So we remove those, but they are very few. And the 2% difference comes because of that. Because we remove some tetrahedrals which are not joined with the main body. Okay, that's why we get that 2% difference. So we reduce the number of triangles, smooth the data, apply 3D mesh. This is what is creating the finite element mesh. And finally, we render the image. Okay. Again, for brick, again, which are similar. The one previous slide was for tetrahedron, and this is for brick element. So we did both brick as well as tetrahedron. What we did not do, which anyone here can do, or I'm not sure if it has already been done. You can take a combination of both. So on the outside, to have a good geometry, you can have tetrahedral elements, and from inside you can have brick elements. So it should be a hybrid kind of thing, which we did not do. Okay, that is. But by now I'm sure I have not checked it. We are working on something else now. Somebody might have done it. So you see, but this makes things slightly more complicated. So you're getting good results because of brick elements, you are getting good geometry because of tetrahedral elements surrounding. So you can have best of both the worlds. Okay. Again, so this is the image. That red color shows the volume of interest. Okay, VOI. This one. All right. Marching cubes algorithm, again Schroeder, he developed this. This basically gives you the surface mesh. Okay, volumetric marching cubes algorithm, WOMAP, Mueller, Luxer. Okay, now 3D mesh was also very interesting. Grid, the whole surface mesh was enclosed in a grid, and you take a vector and it goes from red. These different colors, they mean different types of elements. It could be fat, it could be bone, it could be muscle. And as you, this vector goes from one direction to another, as soon as the color changes. Okay, as the color changes, you see how many times it toggles, and that will tell you what kind of material or what is the thickness of material. So that's very interesting. So you can have several materials, not necessarily the bone, but fat, etc. Bone marrow, red could be even bone marrow, right, etc. This was developed by our another colleague at RPI. Let me just go back. Very interesting guy, Sullivan. Okay, he had developed this 3D mesh program, which we used. Okay? Again, this is the way you change tetrahedrons. Okay, and this can also do mesh refinement. So what this is also a very important part. See, what ENSYS does is basically you can do refine. Why do you need to refine the mesh? Wherever you have lot of stresses, stress concentration, there you require more accuracy. So you try to make smaller elements, but you don't want to make smaller elements everywhere, because that will increase the computational effort. So only when you have a large stress gradient, there you try to refine your element. By refinement, you means you make the finite element smaller. Okay. So this program could do that as well. Okay. So what we did was we took this model of finite element, we fixed one end. Okay. The left face was fixed, and the right face was given 1% of strain. 1% means 0.01. And this just gives a picture of deformed mesh, five times the magnification. Now here, the few graphs, some are important, some are not. Time taken by number of elements, computational time, resolution, FEA time, it's non-linear, and what is the resolution depending on the mesh size and number of elements. Okay. Now this is very important. Okay. Convergence. I told you this is one of the validation. So we found out what is the apparent modulus. Now apparent modulus, we try to calculate. What is apparent modulus? One is tissue modulus, which is a property of the material, right? For example, steel. The steel, what is the Young's modulus of steel? It's a fixed value. It's a material property. Similarly, the bone material, it has a fixed, it's called ET, tissue modulus. It's fixed. But the apparent modulus varies. What is apparent modulus? You take the bone, let's say one piece, fix all this, and apply a strain here. Right? Okay. Apply strain here, and then you can, you from the program, you calculate total force, reaction force, let's call it R. Okay. Divide by strain 0.01, I told you we are giving 0.01 strain, multiplied by total area. Area will be this face, this area. That will give you the EA, apparent modulus. So now you see, there's a difference between apparent modulus and tissue modulus. Apparent modulus varies because of the bone volume fraction. And in general, apparent modulus will be less than tissue modulus. Now just to make sure that you guys are not sleeping, under what condition apparent modulus will be equal to tissue modulus? Anyone? I told you, in general, apparent modulus will be smaller than tissue modulus. Okay, because bone is very hollow. Under what condition do you think apparent modulus will be same as tissue modulus? When the bone,
if bone is solid.
Exactly, when the bone is 100%. solid. A solid bone will have same tissue modulus, same apparent modulus. Okay, because it's a material property. Because as you make bone more and more hollow, EA will keep on decreasing. The apparent modulus will keep on decreasing. For example, if you take a sponge, you know, to compress a sponge is very easy. But if you take the solid material of a sponge, it will be difficult. Just imagine, right? So this is because of the porosity of a sponge, it's very easy to compress it or stretch it. So, I told you this is another validation. So, on the y-axis you have apparent modulus, on the x-axis you have number of elements. Now, we want as few elements as possible. Why? To reduce the computational effort, cost of computation, which is very important. Because we had supercomputers, UIUC has a one huge supercomputer, Cray, right? And we had to take the time on the supercomputer, right? Param we have in India, right? So that for that you have to pay something. So the longer time it takes for computation, the more you have to pay. So one thing is straight, you want your things to do quickly. You want all the computation should not take much time. So for that you want to take less number of elements, right? Because the lesser the number of elements, your size of k will be small, okay, and you can take, it will take less time. But accuracy, for example, suppose you take about, let's say about 5000 elements, you are getting the value of EAS about 87. Do you think that's a good idea? No, because you keep on increasing the number of elements and till you see it has become almost kind of asymptotic. So here about 20,000 or slightly more than 20,000 elements is a good number where your EA value has become almost constant. So if we go back, so you can see here we did this for convergence and we found that A6, model A6 is good enough, which had about 22,000 elements. And then all the further analysis we did on this particular model. So if we go A7, A8, A9, your computational time will increase. If you go A5, A4, A3, A21, results will not be accurate. Okay. So we settled for model A6. Okay.
Okay, oops, going in the wrong direction again.
Okay, here are the local stresses and here, so we, next we studied only this particular model, A6 model, like it says, okay? And here is the element number and every element we calculated stresses and we can see these peaks, fairly high stresses in certain elements. Okay. Similarly, local strains. This red kind of dashed line shows the low the strain that we give about, this is the average. Okay. This is the average strain that we give 1%. Not the red dotted is the average strain, okay, which is less than, and but whereas we can see some peaks they go almost up to 5%. Okay. So actually this line, some mistake, okay, this line, red line should be -1 because we gave 1% of compressive strain. I'll have to go through because I don't know whether this particular presentation has shifted it or, but this red dashed line should be at -1, okay? Because that's the 1% compressive strain we gave externally, okay? And we can see that many elements, right, it went beyond 1%. This is something alarming because that shows your local strains in the bone may be fairly high and it may lead to fracture. Okay, these are again stresses you can see from different colors where we have more stresses, where we have less stresses.
So this software I will use, is it NC?
We use Cosmos. But a better software will be even Nastran or Patron. Those are very high-end software. The three good softwares I'll tell you, IDENA by KJ Bathe, Nastran, Patron. These three software are excellent software. But Ansys is also good. Okay. Otherwise, Cosmos is there, Mark is there, MARC. There's so many softwares available. Dyna is for crash. So if you want to do crash test for automobiles, Dyna is good, D-Y-N-A. Okay. I think that is a part of Ansys. Ansys has bought an excellent fluid CFD software called Fluent. Have you heard about Fluent?
Yes.
It has been bought by Ansys. So one of the modules, if you want to work with a CFD, then Fluent is excellent software. So here we check the effect of Poisson ratio, which is around 0.3, is fairly, it's not changing much, the apparent ratio. Okay? Anisotropy. Okay. I told you the properties in two mutually orthogonal directions. So one is represented by circle. Solid circle and then by asterisk, and you can see the apparent modulus is different in two directions, okay, which shows a bone is not isotropic. This is another interesting observation. Simulation that we did was, you can see this is the original structure, volume of interest, then we removed using image processing, we removed a few pixels from uniformly removed, so age 1, age 2, age 3. We could not go to age 4, then it became all disjointed kind of thing. So this was some sort of osteoporosis simulation. And we saw the normalized stress. So original was we normalized fairly low, and as we keep on aging, we can see this is the deviation, okay, from different models, okay. But there are huge deviation by the way, and but in general also the trend is it keeps on increasing the average normalized stress, okay, as the general bone mass reduces. Then we also did a study on simple tetrahedral model and brick model. Okay. And we obtained, so we can see so many nodes, so many tetrahedrons. Brick model had more nodes and more brick element. That makes it, see, this is what you should check. It has more degrees of freedom compared to tetrahedral. Okay. So this is much stiffer compared to brick. So the results of brick model are more accurate. But I don't know, this is again debatable because the geometry is not very accurate. So this, the results will be get affected by both your stiffness as well as geometry. So this is, you cannot right away say that brick model is more accurate or tetrahedral model is less accurate, okay? Alright. So this is some sort of normalized number of element, loads parameter. Again, you're comparing these two models, okay, and you can see the tetrahedral model, the normal stress, etc., is more. Okay, more number of elements have more stress, basically, for tetrahedral. Okay, because it's a higher peak. That means there are more elements. At x-axis is a stress, so at higher stress, the more elements subjected to stress in tetrahedral model compared to brick model. So we did a single trabeculi. This is something different analysis. Okay. We did various optimization schemes, conjugate gradient, preconditioner conjugate gradient, and incomplete Kolaski conjugate gradient. Okay. Another Guru and Ortega. Okay. This is a good book. Fundamental. They both are professors at Stanford. It's called Golub and Ortega. I think these Jean Golub. Golub. G-A-L-U-P. Numerical Method, one of the best books, very good books. For undergraduate level, we all know Shapra and Kanal, right? Have you heard about Shapra and Kanal? Those are good books. Shastri is another good book, right? For numerical methods. Okay. Here's something interesting. We actually did not solve Ku equal to R, but we changed into an optimization problem. So this equation number one is what we have to solve, and on the other hand, this is equivalent of finding the minima of phi. So problem number one and two, they are problem one is equivalent to problem number two. Okay. In one case, we find out u directly. In the other case, we find out the minima of phi. Okay. They both are same, and what we did was we used different, and we found out, as I'll tell you later, incomplete Kolaski preconditioner for conjugate gradient method. That was the best optimization scheme in order to get u. Okay. Conclusion. 3D tetrahedral elements, we developed a scheme where they could be automatically generated, and so we used tetrahedral elements, and we saw that 1% of compressive strain induces large local strains. Poisson ratio does not have much effect between around 0.3. Okay. Anisotropy, the first one refers to anisotropy, that the apparent modulus was different in two directions. Osteoporosis simulation, the bone volume fraction varied from about 9.7 to about 5%. The stress concentration, this is something very interesting and important. Okay, you folks. The stress concentration increased 5 times for tensile stresses, 3 times for compressive stresses. That's why the people who have osteoporosis or who have less bone mass are more prone to bone fracture compared to a healthy human being with a normal time wise, are we doing okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I should not rush, or should I rush? So. Then we saw, which I did not get into detail, is highly mathematical, but very interesting and easy. It's not, I keep telling you, boring with books. Another good book, Linear Algebra by Gilbert Strang. This is the book you must buy, Gilbert Strang. And you should see the lectures of this guy. He is again a professor at MIT, Gilbert. I have seen his lectures. I have attended his lectures, Gilbert Strang, and the best book is Introduction to Linear Algebra. Okay, so this guy is an amazing guy, and those lectures are available video.google.com or even on YouTube, or if you go to open source, MIT open source. I'm sure all of you are familiar, right? So go for two guys' lectures. Okay, one is Bathe for finite element. Gilbert Strang for linear algebra, and third is Laura Gibson for cellular solids. These three persons, okay? Remember these three persons, they all are from MIT, okay? So you can find, just go to MIT site, go to open sourceware and get their lectures. Listen to them. They're amazing, okay? So we use, this is something interesting. I got it from Gilbert Strang's book. And we tried different types of optimization schemes, and we saw that incomplete Kolaski factorization is very computationally efficient. it converges much faster than some other methods. Okay. So this was a new finding. Several were all these local stresses convergence. When we did, it was the first time anybody had done. Okay. Now, subvolume. Then we were thinking of going for higher volume. Of course, we could not do. This simply shows surface mesh. Okay. This was a higher, bigger model which we could not analyze because we didn't have enough computer hardware and software. Of course, same software we'll use, but the hardware wise was very slow that time. But I'm sure by now I'm telling you what now things are doing. This is an amazing. They do actual validation by experiment. So what I did computationally, they actually compress the bone, okay, and then take the CT scan right away. So you can see the stresses, okay, and you can see the stresses experimentally. And this guy, Reed Bergen, he's from Sweden. This guy has done amazing work, and he has done that work, experimental validation to finite element model. In real time, okay. So we should read about this. Van Reed Bergen, V-A-N. We usually they write with small. This is a common mistake. Von Mises, for example, it's not von Mises. Okay, V is a small. V-O-N, von Mises. Similarly, Van Reed Bergen. Okay, R-I-E-T, Bergen. Van or Von, I'm not sure. I think it's Von. Okay. He's from Sweden and he has done a lot of work. Okay. And he is still very active in this field. A lot of very good work has been done in Belgium and Sweden, not necessarily in US. Okay. Future work, like I said, some of you are interested, you can work with hybrid element modeling if it has already not been done. Okay, then go for a larger volume investigation, right? Tissue heterogeneity, we took the same tissue, so you can take you can combine various tissues, and the property of tissue itself you can take different at different places. And nowadays the work which is going on is most of the work in India also, IIT Bombay and Delhi probably, they are doing on remodeling of bone, computational model of remodeling of bone. So how the bone gets built up and then again it gets broken. So this whole cycle, okay, they are developing a fairly good model of remodeling of bone, both locally and globally. So this is what has been going on right now. This is another very practical work is done by Zimmer. This is a private company, Zimmer. And they have developed artificial trabecular metal. These are used for transplant, etc. Okay, hip transplant. So what they do is